Cooling. Cooling is one of the last steps in the flow of food, and it's oftentimes where people get lazy because cooling happens often at the end of the shift or at the end of the night. Let's say that it is 11 o'clock at night in the restaurant and the kitchen's clean, floor's mopped, people are tired, they're ready to go home or they're ready to go out and go party. And they look and they say, oh, there's a big old pot of chili on the stove. What oftentimes happens with that?
It goes right in the
walk-in. And the funny thing is they'll cover it. They'll put plastic wrap over it and even poke little holes in it, right, to allow it to ventilate and label it. And they'll date it and they'll think, wow, I've done a really good job here. My boss is going to be proud of me. Is that chili going to cool to the right temperature in the right amount of time?
No,
not even close. Studies have shown that it can take products in those big 5-gallon containers and buckets up to 4 days to properly cool. And I've actually seen this firsthand where I went into a restaurant and in their walk-in they had a big bucket of pasta and it was at 46 degrees. Now, they had dated it, so again, it was good. They dated it. I was happy that they dated it, but the date on it said Monday. I was in there on Wednesday. And it was still 46 degrees. So right away I thought, ooh, this hasn't been cooled properly. And so I asked him, I said, you know, have you guys taken this out, you know, at all today? Have you used it? Nope. We cooked it on Monday. It's been in there since Monday. So now I know that even 2 days later, this pasta still hasn't reached 41 degrees or lower. So what that means is it's been in the temperature danger zone, doubling bacteria, every 20 minutes. For 2 days. More than likely, there were absolutely some toxins that were in that product as well. There was nothing they could do to save it. They had to throw away that entire container of pasta because it wasn't cooled properly. You know, just recently, I've gone into several restaurants and we've had to throw away big 5-gallon buckets of soup. Very expensive. You know, had to have to waste all this stock and time. Think about a big 5-gallon bucket. That's all your stock for, you know, you're going to use it the next 2 days. And now we have to start all over again because it wasn't cooled properly. So how do we cool things properly? Well, one of the first things you want to do is reduce the quantity, because I guarantee if they had just separated that pasta into maybe 2 containers, 3 containers, it absolutely would have been cooled to the proper temperature in the right amount of time. So reduce the size, quantity, or density of foods to help facilitate cooling. Stainless steel containers, much better transfer of temperature than plastic. Can you use plastic? Yes, you can. As long as it's a food grade container, that's fine. But stainless steel is going to work much better. However, if the food was cooked in a stainless steel container, you do not want to try to keep cooling it in that same container because it works both ways. It will actually retain the heat, so always transfer it maybe into a new stainless steel container to cool. Covered or uncovered with cooling, what did we say?
Uncovered,
because remember, for hot holding, we want to keep the heat inside, so we keep it covered. For cooling, we want the heat to be able to escape. Another indication that things have been either put in the refrigerator when they're too hot or we've covered them when they're too hot, when you see the condensation that builds up on the inside of the lid, I know right away they're not cooling properly. They're sticking it in there. It's way too hot. So make sure that you leave it uncovered to properly cool. That is also one of the reasons why when we transfer things to refrigerators to finish the cooling process, you always want to store them on the higher shelves. One, because they're cooked, they're ready to eat, but two, because that steam is still going to be continuing to raise off of the product. And if you have that stored underneath something that's cold, now we're going to increase the temperature of that product as well. So you don't store things in a refrigerator to finish the cooling process until they've reached about 70 degrees or room temperature to avoid raising the temperature of the unit. Ice baths or ice wands, these are great tools to help facilitate cooling. A lot of people use these for soups, sauces, stocks, chowders. What I love about these, they're reusable. You can clean it and sanitize it in a 3-bay sink. Some of them are dishwasher safe, but the nice thing, they come in all different sizes and they're really fairly inexpensive. You can get some of those for as cheap as $28, and a great way to cool liquid foods. You can also use an ice bath or a combination of the two. Sometimes what I see people do is they actually fill up one of their sinks with ice water and they'll put all the containers right inside, and that works really well. Some people add ice right to the food, so they'll add ice right to the stock, so they'll add less water in the ingredients of the recipe so that they know they can add cold water or ice at the end. Pastas, broccoli, shrimp, they'll put it in a strainer and then they'll add cold water or ice right on top, and that is an effective way to cool too. Blast chillers or blast freezers, those are units that are specifically designed for cooling. For places that do a lot of cooling, absolutely something to invest in, because not only can those cool, but they can also store the products at that temperature as well. So this would actually be a device where you could leave it overnight. So I could put something in my blast chiller, I can actually stick the probe inside, say I want to set this, I want to get it down to 38 degrees. Once it's at 38 degrees, I actually want to hold it at 38 degrees. So I can leave it overnight, good, done, and come back in the morning and I know that my product was cooled properly. The biggest thing when it comes to cooling, though, is that we are meeting our cooling parameters. So when we were talking about some of the foodborne illnesses, and I said to prevent those foodborne illnesses like Bacillus cereus and Clostridium perfringens, you have to cool properly. Well, what is cooling properly? Cooling properly is getting it from 135 to 70 degrees within the first 2 hours, and then getting it from 70 to 41 in 4 more hours. Total cooling time here is 6 hours. But you have to meet the first part of that requirement. So if I said that I cooled my chili from 135 to 70, or let's say, actually, let's change that up a little bit. I'm going to cool it from 135 to 80 in 2 hours, and then from 80 to 40 in 3 more hours. Is that proper cooling?
No.
No, why not? I didn't get the first part done, so I didn't get it to 70 within the first 2 hours. I was at 5 hours, but it doesn't matter because I didn't meet the first part of the requirement. That is kind of known as your extreme temperature danger zone. That is where the most bacteria is going to grow, so you have to meet the first part of this requirement. What if I cooled the chili from 135 to 40 degrees in an hour and a half? Is that proper cooling?
Yeah.
Absolutely, that's awesome. If I can do it faster, even better, because if I'm doing it faster, I'm reducing the amount of time it's in the danger zone, thus reducing the bacteria that was able to grow. Because is bacteria growing when food is in the cooling process?
Yeah.
Yeah, of course it is. I mean, think about what you're doing. You're taking it through the temperature danger zone. So bacteria is growing. And so if we can do it faster than that, it's going to be a safer product because there's going to be less bacteria in that finished product. And that's why you use a combination of these methods. You can absolutely, even without the use of a blast chiller, get things cooled in under 2 hours, I would say, even from, you know, 135 to 40 degrees. You could do it probably in 90 minutes or less if you're doing a combination of those tactics there. Now, if I walked into a restaurant, and let's say that you had just finished cooking soup, it was boiling, it was up over 200 degrees, you turned the heat off on the soup. It's still on the stove, though. But there's no heat from the stove because, again, it's not on. You haven't separated it. We haven't really started cooling. And I come in and I take the temperature of the soup and it's 160 degrees. Is this a temperature violation?
No.
No, because is it still safe temperature? Yeah, it's not in the danger zone. We're still safe. Am I going to ask you about it?
Yeah.
Yes, absolutely. Because I'm going to say, well, you know, it's not in the steam table. You don't have it in any kind of hot holding equipment. And you haven't started the cooling process. So I'm going to wonder, what are you doing with this? Are you going to keep it hot? Are you going to cool it? I want to know what's going on to make sure that you're going to handle this product safely. But at this point, it is not in the danger zone. And the only reason I bring that up is because the timing of cooling does not start until you enter the temperature danger zone. So some people get confused about cooling because they're thinking, oh, you know, my soup's at 200 degrees and I have 2 hours to get it from 200 to 70 degrees. And that's not the case. We don't start the timing until it actually enters the temperature danger zone. So a lot of people will do that. When they've cooked foods, they just take it out of the oven, just let some of the excessive heat and steam come off of that product before you start the cooling process. Because if you stick your ice wand in soup that's at 200 degrees, one, I might be concerned that your ice wand is gonna melt, but two, it's gonna waste the ice wand. You're gonna get it from 200 down to 170, now you have no more ice wand, and the food still isn't even in the danger zone yet. Most of the food that gets thrown away by inspectors in restaurants is food that's in the cooling process that people weren't able to identify times or temperatures. Where the health department will go in and they'll find chicken in your refrigerator at 60 degrees and we'll say, oh, you know, chicken in there is 60 degrees. And you'll say, oh, yeah, that's because it was cool, or that it's in the cooling process. It was cooked this morning. The next question is going to be, well, what time was it cooked at? And you're going to say, well, I don't know is the answer we usually get. And they'll say, the morning guy did it and he already left. I don't know what time he cooked it at. What do you think happens with that chicken? Yes, it gets thrown away. So the biggest thing is kind of coming up with a plan so that we are able to somehow monitor cooling temperatures. Some people use logs. Some people use post-it notes. We don't really care what you do as long as you're able to keep track of it to make sure that you are in compliance with the temperature requirements. You know, I have gone into restaurants that have tried to, they'll say, you know, we don't have enough room in the steam table, so we're going to, you know, make a makeshift steam table on the stove. And as long as they're able to maintain temperatures, I'm happy with that. But some inspectors are not going to feel comfortable with that practice, that it's going to be done properly on a day-to-day basis. And they might require you to purchase an additional steam table to hold the foods properly. So that can happen sometimes too.